Good evening, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for coming to tonight's event, Confederate Symbols in the Public Square. I'm Melinda Maynor Lowry, Director of the Center for the Study of the American South at UNC. Our mission at the center is to nurture rigorous scholarship, critical conversations, and creative expressions for a diverse and changing South. Through the Southern Oral History Program, research grants and fellowships, the journal Southern Cultures, and in our public lectures, conversations, and performances, we elevate the stories of Southern communities to serve their futures. We welcome you who seek a creative, enterprising, and inclusive South. Tonight's event wouldn't be possible without the staff at the center, for whom I'm very grateful, the Friday Center for Continuing Education, especially its director, Rob Bruce, the Stone Center for Black Culture and History, and the Department of American Studies. We're so grateful for their support. The plan for tonight's conversation and this particular group of people we've convened, who I'll introduce in a minute, emerged on August 14th, 2 days after the horrifying violence in Charlottesville, Virginia. I want to set the stage for our conversation first. The staff of our journal, Southern Cultures, drafted a statement in response to Charlottesville, evoking the very real consequences of memories that have been distorted. Our center as a whole embraced it, and we set about integrating our work for this semester to nurture this important conversation. Units across UNC Chapel Hill's campus, including departments, centers, and institutes in every quarter, Wilson Library, and the University History Council have also participated with statements and transformative conversations on their own. I especially want to thank Cecilia Moore, where are you, Cecilia? There she is, for being here tonight, representing the University History Council, and Lloyd Kramer, part of the Carolina Public Humanities, who held a very important conversation along these lines several weeks ago, and Harry Watson for drafting the statement that you start to see at the beginning. Southern Cultures has curated a set of classroom resources to discuss these issues and their long histories. So we're engaged with this current moment, but here tonight to offer a unique, longer-term perspective. I myself am a native Southerner, a member of the Lumbee tribe of North Carolina, which means that my ancestors were Southerners before there was this thing that we came to call the South. My own research and writing also revolves around American Indian and Southern history after the Civil War. And research in that area begins with recovering lost histories. American Indian Southerners are today wrestling with our erased or invisible histories, why we are often the only ones who care about them, and who erased these histories and how. So when I hear folks talking, both before and since Charlottesville, about their histories and these symbols being erased, I'm very curious about their points of view. I'm also curious about those who argue that the monuments should be taken down because our society is very different now. But after Charlottesville, we at the center asked ourselves, how different are the values of the society we live in now and the values of the society that put up these monuments? Just as there have always been people who objected to celebrating the Civil War in this fashion, there have always been people who agreed. Are our two societies now and then so very different? I'm going to ask our assistants to play a clip from the Southern Oral History Program's podcast, Press Record. This is from their most recent episode, released just yesterday, and the topic is Confederate monuments and how oral history helps us unpack their meanings. The people you'll hear in just a minute are UNC Professor William Sturkey, who is a professor of African American history, and Mystery Bonds, an undergraduate activist who is ready to remove our own Confederate statue, Silent Sam. Yes, can you play the clip?
One of the ways that I can teach the statue in class is to bring in sort of the very same rhetoric and educational mission of groups like the United Daughters of the Confederacy, who not only built statues, but went into public schools to try and argue and teach people that the war wasn't about slavery, that slavery wasn't that bad. In many cases, they offered the lesson that African Americans were actually better off under slavery because they don't know what to do with themselves now that they've been liberated, right? So again, that's sort of enforcing that moral superiority. So I mean, that's what Jim Crow really was. And that's one of the things that I wanted to really hit on in terms of taking down the statues. We've done a lot of other things. We've taken down the colored only signs or whites only signs, those legacies of the Jim Crow South. We now study different types of people. We allow new perspectives, right, that more fully capture the American experience, the Southern experience in our classrooms. We allow people of color to work at places like Duke and UNC and NC State and Wake, et cetera. One thing we have not done is remove these sort of pro-white supremacist monuments from our landscape.
The University of Chapel Hill has such an opportunity to signal to other states, other campuses, that it's not okay to have these symbols on our campuses that discount an entire population of people. We take the Confederate monument down. The hope is that other campuses will. And also clear up the argument. So we're saying that we want the statue removed from campus, but we're not saying destroy it, because we do realize that for some, the statue does represent grandfathers and cousins, etc. And while I don't necessarily like what they fought for, that's still family members. So what we're saying is, let's move it to a place where it can be contextualized, not a place of honor.
So these kinds of reflections brought us to invite these guests here tonight. Blair L.M. Kelly has already moved the needle on this conversation in one of our most influential public squares on Twitter. The day after Charlottesville, she questioned the response to the violence, changing the popular hashtag #ThisIsNotUs, used to describe the violence, to #ThisIsUs. Dr. Kelly is the Assistant Dean for Interdisciplinary Studies and International Programs for the College of Humanities and Social Sciences at North Carolina State University. She's also Associate Professor of History. She researches the history of African-American social movements and is author of the award-winning book, Right to Ride, Streetcar Boycotts and African-American Citizenship in the Era of Plessy versus Ferguson. Her forthcoming book on Black feminist scholar and activist Anna Julia Cooper, edited with Melissa Harris Perry, will be published by Yale University. Dean Kelly has also been a guest on NPR's Here and Now and MSNBC's Melissa Harris Perry show. She has written for the New York Times, the Washington Post, The Root, Ebony, and Salon. Kelly produces and hosts a podcast, Historical Blackness. She is much admired by her colleagues for her over 27,000 Twitter followers. And you should check out her excellent historical and cultural contextualization of the recent Dove ad. We bring Grace Hale for her expertise in Southern history and culture, but also as an eyewitness to the tragedy in Charlottesville. She's a professor of American Studies and History at the University of Virginia. Professor Hale holds a PhD from Rutgers and specializes in the history and culture of the American South, popular music, and documentary studies. She has written two books on whiteness: A Nation of Outsiders, How the White Middle Class Fell in Love with Rebellion in Postwar America, and Making Whiteness, The Culture of Segregation in the South, 1890 to 1940. Her new book, Cool Town, Athens, Georgia, and the Promise of Alternative Culture in Reagan's America, will be released by UNC Press in 2018. Her documentary studies work, including Documentary Noise, The Soundscape of Barbara Koppel's Harlan County, USA, was featured in the spring 2017 issues of Southern Cultures. Dr. Hale has also written pieces for the New York Times, the Washington Post, and CNN. Finally, Sheffield Hale manages the conflicts and contradictions of the South with the public on a daily basis. He is president and CEO of the Atlanta History Center, which collects, researches, publishes on, and celebrates the history of the Atlanta community. An attorney by training, he served as chief counsel of the American Cancer Society prior to joining the Atlanta History Center in 2012. Mr. Hale serves as a trustee of the National Trust for Historic Preservation, the Robert W. Woodruff Library of Atlanta University Center, and the Atlanta Convention and Visitors Bureau. He's a past chair of the Georgia Trust for Historic Preservation, St. Jude's Recovery Center, and the State of Georgia's Judicial Nominating Commission. Last week, in fact, the mayor of Atlanta asked him to co-chair the city's Monuments Commission. So over the next 30, 40 minutes or so, we're going to have a conversation that centers around questions such as these and images, which I'll show you in a minute. Thank you. So, team, what do you think? Should we relocate monuments? Should we remove them? Interpret them in place? What are the consequences of each of those paths?
Well, everyone's looking at me, and maybe that's because this is quite the issue in my town. I live four blocks from Emancipation Park, so this is... It's on. Hello. Can you hear me now? What should I do?
All right, keep talking.
Okay, I can just talk louder. How's
is that?
That?
Okay, there we go.
We did test this earlier. Sorry about that. So I live in Charlottesville, a few blocks from the parts of the city that you've seen in the news all of the time. I'd just like to start by saying I'm not sure that there's one answer to all of the Confederate monuments across our nation, one answer about what we should do with them, although I would generally suggest moving them out of central positions on college campuses or parks and putting them in places where they can be presented with more context. But I do think that sometimes the local particularities can be different and can mean that different solutions should be possible. But in Charlottesville, we have decided to move them. It's something that I've lived there 20 years. I personally think we should have moved them 20 years ago. But as you know, if you have been paying attention to the news at all, our city council voted to move them in the spring. And as a result of that, every month since that vote, since March, we have had a white supremacist, neo-Nazi / alt-right rally in our town, including just Saturday night. So this has become, you know, very much an issue in our town. But it seems to me that we have to move these statues out of these central places. In the city of Charlottesville, every public park space in our downtown, which is a very small area, has a Confederate monument. We have three Confederate monuments in downtown Charlottesville. It's not a very big town. So this gives you a sense of the extent of the memorialization there. And we need to move these monuments. Probably should have done it already, but we definitely need to move them now. The city council wants to move them to Appomattox. That seems like a great idea to me. It's a national park. We can put those statues in the national park where they can be contextualized. That's where Lee surrendered, so our statue of Lee, I think, would make a lot of sense there. But I do think we also have Confederate monument on our campus, on the University of Virginia campus. And it seems to me that college campuses, centers of towns, these are not places that need to have Confederate monuments. And I think the reason for that is because these monuments were put up in the early 20th century to support a particularly a false view of the past. And I think what's interesting about the present is that in 2017, we can see that what the monument builders hoped to accomplish, to some degree, they succeeded in accomplishing. They succeeded in anchoring their vision of the past, that the Civil War wasn't about slavery, in the landscape of the South, and we're still fighting about it in places like Charlottesville today. So I don't want to just keep talking, as I know that my esteemed colleagues have a lot to say. But in Charlottesville, we need to move these monuments, and I think universities and colleges need to move these monuments. And for the most part, I would say we need to move these monuments, although, again, I'd hesitate to say the particularities of the local situation do need to be examined.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, since I'm going to be on this commission, I need to keep on my powder dry on what we should do. We have to decide. I think that your point is it really is a local decision, and it needs to be decided on a case-by-case basis, depending on the monument. And one of the things that we decided to do at the Atlanta History Center was to create a website that people in local communities could go to research, learn how to research their monument and contextualize them, learn about the lost cause, you know, research what does it mean. The real issue here, and then they can decide, and they can take this potential marker that they could come up on their own to either contextualize it or start a conversation that might go to removal. It depends on the community, depends on where it is. I mean, the ones that I think are the most problematic are the ones in front of courthouses, where people have to go by active courthouses every day and have some judicial action taken. Those are particularly troublesome to me. But it really is something that I think is a community decision that's based, should be based on dialogue about what the monuments are about, which is really what you said, the Jim Crow South, the ones that are in the later period. I think we can probably may be able to agree that the earlier monuments that are in cemeteries that were done closely after the war are less problematic. I said there aren't. And those aren't the ones we're generally talking about today, the ones that are put in the public square. I think the question is, it depends, and of course that's a very political answer because I'm now about to be on a political commission.
For me, I think it's incredibly important to remember the context and to remember the intended effect of constructing them in the spaces that you talked about. To put them in a park, to put them in front of a courthouse was to say that only certain people can find justice at this courthouse. It was to say that this is not a park for Black patrons in the South. It is to say that you are unwelcome in the space, and that's their origin. They don't come at random. They don't come immediately after the war. They come in the face of African-American resistance to segregation and to African-American attempts to gain their civil rights. And so they were part of an argument. And so if we want that argument to continue to be the answer is you should feel uncomfortable here, then we should leave them. But if we want that argument to say that no American should feel uncomfortable at their state-run campus, no American should feel uncomfortable at the courthouse where they're going to seek justice. Now they still might, right? So moving that symbol doesn't necessarily change the power dynamics that are still at play in those very spaces. But I think it's important to recognize the effect that was intended in the beginning and to know that it still has that effect on the population of people. When I was growing up, my mother made a habit of teaching me and pointing out to me the symbols of the Confederacy that were all around. The Dukes of Hazzard was the very first thing I can remember not knowing anything about. I was 6 years old when it first came out. And she taught me that that's why they named the car the General Lee. That flag is the flag of the Confederacy that was intended to maintain slavery. The show is not for you, even though your friends in first grade are watching it. They can watch it. You can't watch that. And so she taught me about Six Flags over Georgia, and we didn't go to that park. She taught me when we went to upstate Pennsylvania to take me to camp that, you know, notice that they'll have the flags here. They didn't fight on the Confederacy, and it's funny, the flags are here. Why do you think that is? And so it was part of how I learned about the terrain of what was safe and what wasn't safe, places I could stop to eat and couldn't stop to eat. And markers of a past that African Americans like my mother lived in a completely different context, where they literally could not stop, where they literally would not be fed or housed or could not stay. And so the residue of that history, it's all over these monuments. And so if communities choose to keep them and choose to remember them, they need to remember that history too.
Yeah, I mean, I guess one of the questions I have is, can you turn them from an object of veneration into an artifact? And that's what, you know, contextualization is intended to do. Does that work? And I think we've had a lot of talk about that, very little talk about contextualizing in place lately. I mean, there was some of that earlier on. After Charlottesville, it's more into either removal and take them and put them in a museum. And by the way, there aren't that many museums that really want them. we're full up, okay?
You've checked those boxes.
We checked, done. But the issue is, can you turn it into, you know, can you turn it into the artifact that it is and take the power away from it? And that's a question that I think I don't have the answer to, and it depends on the artifact and where it is and who you are.
Actually offer the proper recontextualization, though I think that's an admirable idea. And just again get back to the particular, there was a round of recontextualization going on right when I moved to Charlottesville. And that recontextualization is the plaque that says Confederate Heroes Remembered right under General Lee's statue. So that was a recontextualization, an attempt to make it better than it had been before. So I think part of the problem with the recontextualization is trying in a very small amount of text, given that people aren't going to stand in a park and read a book, to explain to people that this is a false vision of the past that is put into stone so that it looks like it's you know, that it has the kind of legitimacy and heft that will carry through time. It's hard to actually convey that in a small amount of text on a plaque. But I just wanted to offer one other sort of specific account, and that is, you know, we say this all the time, historians say this all the time, these memorials were put up to, you know, by people in the early 20th century, and it was about what they were doing then. It was about their expansion of white Southerners' expansion of segregation, their attempts to legitimate their segregated system and give it a kind of glorious past, and attempts to sort of anchor their vision of the past and their ancestors' heroism in their vision as a true story. And we say that, but that seems kind of abstract. And I think one of the things that's really interesting about Charlottesville is the Stonewall Jackson statue, which is right by the courthouse. They actually tore down an African-American neighborhood in the 19-teens to build that park. Mm-hmm. And that takes the abstract and makes it concrete for you. It was an African-American neighborhood, a place that African-Americans lived because white Southerners, you know, white Charlottesvillians wanted them to live close to the courthouse, close to the hotels, close to the houses of the wealthy where they worked. But then in the early 20th century, caught up in the sweep of the City Beautiful movement, they suddenly didn't want them to live there anymore. And there started to be complaints about what young African-American men were doing, or you know, teenagers were doing after hours, harassing white people. And so the city took over the row of housing called McKee's Row, tore it down, condemned the street, and found a wealthy white supremacist local, a person who had been born in Charlottesville but moved away and made his fortune, Paul McIntyre, to donate the money for the statue. So just to give you that story, not because Charlottesville's particularly, you know, that special or that important, but it sounds abstract, but when you see that it actually was, how it actually was built by tearing down, erasing an African-American neighborhood, I think it just sort of makes that abstraction concrete.
Mm-hmm. I wonder, Sheffield, if you have any, based on the tools that you have provided for local communities, if there's any feedback from that effort to where people have tried this, made a decision, recontextualized, how it went.
The one example that we know of that was used, and we didn't know that they were doing it, was the University of Mississippi. They tried to recontextualize their statue. It's in the middle of the campus, very similar to a Silent Sam here. And they forgot to involve the history department.
They forgot.
And so the next thing they knew, they got a petition from 30 members of the history department saying, gee, this is unacceptable. You should use the Atlanta History Center's marker that we found online to do this. And then we found about it. Somebody tweeted that to me, and I said, this is pretty cool. And so then they did it. And I'm not saying that that's ended it, but it basically acknowledges on the statue that, you know, 40% of Southerners were enslaved, you know, and that was really what the war is about. And one of the things I like to talk about is that, you know, more than half of Southerners were against the war. Like people say, what are you talking about? Well, 40% of them were enslaved. And then you get to the point where people say, oh, I guess they're Southerners. And it's a way of shifting and talking about and getting at the lost cause, because I think the real issue here is beyond the statues is the fact that most people believe that the war, more people believe, was not about slavery, it's about something else. And that, you know, these history folks over here need to get busy.
I took a whole class at UVA that was about, like, how it really wasn't about slavery. It was like a big Rube Goldberg thing.
Yeah.
And really? It was just a series of accidents.
Yeah.
I wasn't teaching that class.
That's, I mean, I run into that every day at a public history museum, and I'm sure y'all do with, you know, people coming, students coming in. And it's not because they're bad people or anything like that. It's because that's what they were told. That's what their parents and grandparents and their teachers and the UDC, which was the greatest propaganda organization ever created, in terms of effectiveness, taught them. And it's something you want to believe if you're a white Southerner. And so, because it's convenient. And so, those are the people, and that's the issue I think we need to get at, is how do we convince people that 40% of Southerners count? Mm-hmm. And they're part of history, and they're part of the South, and they're part of our heritage.
But I would, I mean, I hear what you're saying, but when historians have been saying for decades, that was what the Civil War was really about, and it's not having that much effect, you know, what is to be done?
Well, that's the definition of insanity, right? But but we still have to try, right? And we have to come up with new ways to tell what I think is an obvious problem. Is it's obvious to us, it's not obvious to other people.
But I also think it's bigger than the South, right? So
yeah.
in watching what happened in Charlottesville, those people aren't mostly from Charlottesville. Most of those people probably weren't even from Virginia. A lot of them were from
the West Coast.
West Coast, Massachusetts,
Ohio, Pennsylvania.
Killer was from Ohio.
So, yeah, a lot of them were, their families weren't in the United States when the Civil War was fought. So it's not so much necessarily about a better reckoning with people's history and their own personal sense of the South or Americanness, but the way in which this, the notion of white supremacy and the Confederacy gather a series of thoughts for people about what's wrong with their lives, and that suddenly they are struggling because there have been changes over the past decades that allowed other people to have voices in those same public squares. And so it isn't so much about the actual history and the actual places all the time, but I think a lot of what it might symbolize and what it attracts, and what you know people like Richard Spencer are exploiting to their own benefit.
Yeah, and we really saw that in Charlotte. We see that. What am I saying? Saw that. They were just here again Saturday night. We see that in Charlottesville. They come with symbols from all over the world and various sort of historic movements and moments that they point to, most obviously the Confederacy and the Nazi period in Germany, but others as well. And they've sort of gathered up a set of historical stories, fantasies really, that give their kind of ideology and their present politics in their minds a kind of heroic past. And it really has become one of those stories.
I mean, one thing I'd like to distinguish though is between those people that are there and have this sort of Game of Thrones, whatever fantasy that they have about the Confederacy, and people who are sort of in the middle, who aren't out there doing this, who believe the lost cause, they're not the same. There are a lot of people that believe in the lost cause who are not carrying tiki torches and are not neo-Nazis. And those are the people I'm interested in talking to. These folks, other folks, they're just using these symbols for a political purpose. It's not about the Confederacy, it's not about the monuments, it's about their own political thing, and they're just playing off of that. But what about the people that are actually reachable that we can talk to?
I wonder how those people feel about being wedded to a history useful to folks who do carry tiki torches.
Yeah.
That's maybe your opening, right?
That might be a persuadable point. It seems to me too that what we're talking about here are how people define truth, and as trained historians or people who are students of history on a deep level, we look at facts, we look at dates, we look at when these things were put up and the rhetoric that was used to put them and the erasure of black communities as they, and their replacement with these monuments and symbols. And that's how, what we call truth, you know. But then there's another way in which history and narratives are used to tap into underlying deeper issues and perhaps deeper truths for some people are deeply aware of. I imagine the white supremacists who gather in Charlottesville are, yeah, deeply aware of the political purpose to which they're using the narrative. But the folks that subscribe to lost cause explanations, but yet are not, you know, would not consider themselves white supremacists, are perhaps, I don't know if they've not had these conversations with themselves, or if there's a lack of access to, or if historians are not doing their job to speak or redefine truth.
Well, I think part of it can be we're not talking to people. I can sometimes be condescending. My wife will tell me that, right? She's in the audience. and we can be that way a lot of times. And we need to talk to people in a real way as people. Mm-hmm. And the, one of the ways I like to do it, it doesn't necessarily mean it works, right? So that's a definition of sanity. But it's to use the words of the people, you know, we talked about this, who erected the statues. Don't believe me, believe what they said. You know, watch the dates when they were erected. What was going on? What did they say? They were pretty obvious, pretty out front about what they were doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, that actually is a good transition to our second issue, which is the public square. And where are the public squares, or which public squares can house dialogue that's most constructive? In this particular moment, we have a wide variety of them. We have us here tonight. We also have classrooms, we have social media, we have legislatures, we have, you know, direct action on streets. From y'all's experience, what you've witnessed, where do you think are the places that we can actually have these constructive conversations?
I would think that it's interesting, because there's a layer of sort of like what would be constructive, and then what actually gets the conversation moving. So, I mean, I know that the people on this campus have been talking for years about the symbols on this campus, and it really never pierced a local consciousness very well, let alone a national consciousness. But both Charlottesville and the actions taken by the folks in the city to plan to take them down, and the sort of violent response to that, as well as Durham, North Carolina's pulling down of the statue in front of the courthouse. Both those things sort of spurred more of a conversation, along with the Baltimore mayor's move to take them out in the nighttime. So I think that inaction didn't really start a conversation. And doing nothing just allowed nothing to continue as the placeholder.
Doing nothing in terms of not getting out in
the
street.
Yeah, nothing happened. I mean, there were people who were protesting, but nothing was sort of, you know,
moving ahead
yeah. or changing how people thought of this, or making it a bit of a crisis that campuses and communities need to address in a quick way. And so I do think it's important to give credit to those who are organizing and making movement to contest them, because I think that's a lever by which we see, you know, all of a sudden, you know, when Durham was trending on Twitter, I was like, wait, what happened in Durham? Sweet Durham is trending. Mm-hmm. And so that, you know, piercing the consciousness is an important part of the work. But I also do think, speaking of social media, that it is, we live in a very different environment where a lot of people can give feedback, who are everyday people, to people who are making news, and they can drive a story. So it wasn't possible, I think, before social media to drive a story as hard as you can.
For ordinary Americans to be irritated
by something, and then it makes the news. So I do think that social media plays a big part. And it's not the best place to have a conversation necessarily, but it's also not the worst place if you do it in ways that are constructive and grounded in the context. And so, I mean, that's part of what I believe in the work I do, because I think you can really spur a lot of different kinds of communities who aren't normally talking to historians or normally conversing with journalists. You can bring them into the same space very easily without a lot of effort. And so I do think that's not where it should end, but it's really where it can begin.
I think another good way to have these conversations is actually to take people into these spaces. I've been teaching 20th century Southern history at UVA for 20 years now, and I've always taken my giant, you know, lecture class on a lost cause Confederate walking tour of Charlottesville, which is a little disconcerting in the town when you have like 150 students tromping through, but it always works. Just to have them go and stand, I mean, why should I lecture about the lost cause in a lecture hall when I can take them and show them, you know, statues that are supposedly some of the finest Confederate statues made, however we define that, and have them just really look at those statues and see how they're placed in the landscape and have that conversation. And the way that I start that conversation when I get there, at least recently, I was in Germany as a Fulbright scholar, and since I came back from Germany, I always started this way. I say, how many of you guys have been to Europe? Has anybody been to Germany? And some people will always raise their hand, and I say, so did you notice all those statues about Hitler all over Germany in the parks and stuff? Did you see those SS officers, you know, the anonymous SS officer in front of the public, you know, the city building? And the students are all laughing, you know, this is like ridiculous, why would I think that? And it just is a way to sort of to get them to start to think about, it's a bizarre thing to have statues to the generals and the president of traitors to the nation in front of public government buildings and in public parks. And I think there's a way, and I think I'm guilty of this, and many of us who've grown up in the South, there's a way in which this somehow is normal to us, and it's a bizarre, not normal thing to have these kinds of monuments to a side that lost a civil war up all over the landscape. And so I just try to start that conversation, at least with my undergrads, by sort of unsettling them and getting them to sort of just try to think about why this is a weird thing, you know, to have this statue here.
Well, of course, I would say the best place are public history museums.
Because you would say that.
Yeah, I would say that. They're the most trusted, trusted by on all sorts of polls. Which we had that redone this year because we're using that poll from like 1996. I noticed the other day, so let's make sure there's more up to date. but that's one way. But you know, actually, I thought the other night on I don't know if y'all saw the John Oliver show last week tonight. I thought he had a really pretty funny way of dealing with it. It was accurate historically and funny, and he reached a whole bunch of people who had no idea about Confederate monuments, about what they were, and with humor and accuracy, and in a way that it's hard for me to do. That's one way. I mean, to try to do it in a different form, that's just a different form. I don't know if that's the perfect one, certainly not, but I thought it was pretty damn fun.
It was the number one trending video on YouTube as of yesterday, something like that. So thinking about humor as a way to reach people and entertainment never really gets old. What, you know, in this state, we're dealing with a kind of seeming deadlock around the roles of university administrators, governors such as our Board of Governors, our legislature, our State Historic Commission. Are there, or how would you all describe the roles of those public agents or people who are accountable to voters in this type of discussion? Just speaking of what you know.
Okay,
in your
as
own
a
context.
Lawyer on the panel.
We're going to hear from the lawyer.
Now, I think, for example, the laws that are on the books in a lot of states, including Georgia, North Carolina, and Tennessee, that restrict removal of these monuments.
We have it in Virginia.
In Virginia, are bad for everybody concerned. For one thing, they create an atmosphere where, like what happened in Durham, would happen because people feel like they have no option, right? They don't have a way to deal with that. And so even for people who want to keep them and, you know, maybe contextualize it or do something else, it shuts down the dialogue, and I think that's very unhealthy. And so I think that legislatures, and in Georgia's actually looking at it now because it's a very conservative thing to restrict localities as to what they can do.
I was going
to
comment on that.
Yeah, states' rights.
Yeah, you know,
local rights,
local rights, right? Yeah. So it's the irony of it is like if everything else is just wonderful. But they're actually thinking about changing the law in this legislature for that reason.
Yeah, they're trying to get the law changed in Virginia too. But
but anyway, so the answer is, you know, who decides And I think that the closer you can get it to the people, even if they're the local locality decides not to, at least they have an opportunity for somebody to raise the issue and try to move it forward in their location. Because they aren't going to be removed everywhere because people differ on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, from another perspective, it seems like the more sort of groups have a say in making decisions, the more they're all trying to pass the buck. I mean, mm-hmm. There seems to be some of that going on in a lot of places where people are sort of hoping somebody else will, it's your decision, you make it.
Yeah, we're going to give it to a commissioner.
So and you can be on it.
And yeah, you can be on it. Yeah, great.
Coaching.
A lot of friends.
But I do think that's a tried and true method of managing crisis, right? Is to appoint a commission and study it and never do anything. So.
And yeah. I also, it makes me think of at the moment where we chose to put on public land and in public institutions these monuments in the first place, there wasn't sort of this like lovely, civil, inclusive conversation about what we should do.
No.
That's not where they come from. That's not their origins. Oftentimes these are private attempts and they're given public land and public funding to do something. And so Black people were taxpayers and not included in any kind of lovely conversations at the time.
And like in Richmond, actively fought against the
Absolutely.
Monument Avenue.
Fought against them all over.
So that was documented and it's like people don't remember that it's, no, this is not a new issue.
Where they could safely fight against them.
Yeah.
It's also possibly worth historians pointing out that the laws protecting the monuments are relatively new compared to the existence of the monuments themselves. In North Carolina, I'm not sure how old the law is, but it's not very old. It doesn't date to the installation of these particular structures. And the way that different states in the South, this sort of leads into our next question in a way, the way different states in the South have dealt with flags, the issue of the battle flag, where it flies, how it flies, or other kinds of symbols of the Confederacy, people have been able to adapt, perhaps not always willingly and not easily, but they have been able to adapt. So there's a piece of context perhaps there that's worth remembering. And speaking of diversity, so one of the things that we value at the Center for the Study of the American South is how we can understand the region as a heterogeneous place, where it's not one thing everywhere, and the region is far more than the former states of the Confederacy. And Southerners does not simply mean white Southerners, it means all kinds of Southerners, people who live in the South. So what we've seen in the last several years is, as y'all know, is these controversies unfolding in different places and different localities deciding to handle them differently. So I'm wondering your reflections on what that says about the region, how it reflects diversity, how is New Orleans different from Memphis, different from Richmond or Baltimore, and then also what are the underlying issues that all these places sort of share?
Well, I think you're seeing the removal happening in places that have the most diverse communities. And you're seeing them in the largest cities. You're not seeing them in the second tier of cities in terms of population size. Yeah, I mean, you've got Charlottesville, but that's, it's like Chapel Hill. It's a little island of preciousness, right?
That's probably it.
Yeah, and
the right word,
but you've got, you've got Baltimore, which in New Orleans, which are both heavily African American, and don't have laws against removing them, right? Memphis is heavily African American, but there's a Tennessee law that restricts that. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's part of it, I think. But we haven't seen this really move down to the Macon, Georgias, or the smaller towns in any large way. Yeah.
Places where perhaps the political economic situation is very different.
I mean, I think one of the things about the monuments that's interesting is that they project a fairly uniform, sort of unified kind of image of what the South is and what its history has been and what's important that's actually really a problem. And so that's part of the reason I think that monuments are in this particular moment, they're so much critique and that we need to think about moving them is because they're sort of giving us a unified story that doesn't actually fit the contemporary moment and the populations that live in these spaces, but doesn't actually fit the past either. Doesn't fit the kind of diverse and many kinds of actors in the historical story. It doesn't fit that, and so I think that it actually cuts against that diversity, and that's actually one of the problems, mm-hmm. one of the key problems. The other thing that I would say though is that removal of statues is not always the number one issue of communities everywhere who might not necessarily be supportive of those statues. The activist community in Charlottesville, the African American activist community, hasn't ever liked the statues, but they've had other issues that they've been more motivated to work on, and that's again part of the diversity of the region, and I think that's probably very much true in some of these cities that, I forget the term you used, but the smaller cities. I mean, in some of those places, activists have other agendas. Maybe they are interested in funding for the schools or something else. So I don't think that we should necessarily presume that's the number one issue that everyone wants to work on.
I do think it's also generational.
Yeah.
I think that this current millennial generation is impatient with things that previous generations grew to tolerate and ignore or just sort of deal with in different kinds of ways, and they are now asking why is this still going on? There's a sort of sense that we should have done something before now among younger people who are just sort of disgusted with the idea of campuses with buildings with names of slave owners and white supremacists and statues in their honor. And so I think they are a bit impatient in a way that I think previous generations were like, but so let's do the substantive work. Let's do
voting rights
that make a bigger difference in terms of the lived experience of being in these communities. Mm-hmm. But I think you can do both, and I don't think it has to be a sort of competing thing. And I think if we talk about the symbolism, we talk about the history, we talk about exclusions, we talk about the harder things that have happened in our past, we get to all of those things in having those symbolic conversations. So, you know, seeing Bree Newsom take down the flag, you know, like I don't think anyone in my generation would have, they just would have complained about it. They really wouldn't
they would have
necessarily sort of like, I need to go get it. But the symbolic resonance of that act, that sort of victory, against something that had sort of hung over a lot of people's heads for generations. I think it's interesting to watch it. So I think it's, you know, being in the post-Obama moment when we have this sort of very symbolic presidency, I think taught a lot of people about more about symbols than we thought we knew.
Yeah. It's a time period when that kind of cultural politics and symbolic politics is really powerful. And I think that younger people are really responding as well. This comes back to something we were talking about earlier, to right-wing groups' use of these symbols. So it is also their impatience. Mm-hmm. Why didn't we get rid of them before? I completely agree with what you said, but I think it's also kind of in dialectic with what conservative groups are using these symbols for. And the kids, you know, these kids have grown up in the era of the heritage, not hate, kind of stuff, and the activists, neo-Confederates that really, really got very active on, you know, what we could call the forerunners to social media in the 90s. So there has been a kind of growing sophistication amongst white conservatives in their use of these symbols and these histories, and I think that activists are responding to that as well. Mm-hmm. You know, that they're unhappy with that, and they don't want these symbols to still be there for those people to use in those ways.
Thank you. We're going to ask, I'm going to pose some general questions for all of us to sort of think about for a minute. And then the images that we've brought tonight were all suggested by our guests. And the images in different ways kind of reflect these questions. So I'll just ask us to consider whose history Confederate symbols represent. We've talked about that, of course, to some degree already tonight. You've heard about it elsewhere. Interesting question also for me, especially as a Native person studying Native history, is what should we commemorate as Southerners and as Americans if we don't assume that those two categories are separate and we assume that we need to consider them together? What should we actually be talking about? And then what do people ultimately choose to see or not to see about the American South? I thought the point you just made about how monuments impose a kind of singular or monolithic narrative on the whole region that is not accurate or never actually existed is something that folks have chosen to see, and perhaps then the diversity has been things that people have chosen not to see. Are there responses to these ideas that you guys want to offer at the moment? I should have given you, like,
I think,
meeting
well,
Zoom card.
I just think in terms of who should commemorate, we just ought to be damn careful who we put on a pedestal, right?
Yeah.
And we don't need
We're
to be promiscuous 100 years about later. That like we have been in
yeah.
the past.
We call this the Thomas Jefferson problem at UVA.
Yeah, TJ. Mm.
Yeah. So.
Why do you say that?
He's
yeah.
everywhere. He's
every
everywhere.
Historical figure is complicated, and
you think,
you know, yeah. I'm sorry to state the obvious, but at UVA, this is something that still has to be stated. Sorry.
It's interesting, you know, as a UVA undergrad, that was before Sally Hemings was confirmed as the mother of his children, and so I spent most of my undergrad, you know, arguing in history classes with people who were like, that's a scurrilous rumor, and he would never.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
you know, he was about freedom, and he just cared about freedom. Like, no, it's more complex than that.
Yeah.
I wrote a,
he didn't just care about that.
An undergraduate paper that I got a really bad grade on.
it
was called Thomas Jefferson, Father and Master.
Yeah.
Question mark.
Yeah.
yeah. So he's been in my head all my historian life.
Well, I have a proposal. Let's memorialize and commemorate the Civil Rights Movement. I mean, Southerners made the Civil Rights Movement, and that changed the country. And
I'm
so
for Ella Baker statues everywhere.
That doesn't seem to be a hard one to me. Let's commemorate the Civil Rights Movement. There's very little public commemoration. Not there is some, but there is not that much public commemoration of the Civil Rights Movement, and we could certainly have a lot more of that.
We just added Martin Luther King to the Georgia State Capitol grounds, so he gets to join John B. Gordon, Tom Watson, and a host of other John Brown, Joe Brown. So it's a very complicated menagerie of statues down there. But, he's there.
Y'all have a John Brown statue?
Joe Brown.
Joe
Brown.
He said
sorry.
John Brown, and I knew.
Yeah, sorry, I was wrong.
He didn't mean
Governor
that.
Joe Brown.
All right, there you go.
The governor. Yeah. And John B. Gordon on his horse. Mm. The only three non-racist things on the Capitol grounds are Jimmy Carter, Martin Luther King, and John B. Gordon's horse.
Well, you don't know about the horse. You can't.
No,
sure.
I think the horses. We're gonna have to give the horse a pass.
God bless Jimmy Carter, too. What do we do without him? Well, one of the things in the aftermath of Charlottesville that I happened to tweet was, you know, that we should commemorate the Lumbee tribe's ambush of the Ku Klux Klan in 1958.
There you go.
That, you know, when that occurred, that event occurred in January 1958, that was a, you know, tremendous victory against this terrorist organization that a number of Lumbee, 500 Lumbee men and women gathered to make sure that the Klan could not hold a rally in January of that year on land that was adjacent to ours. It was a kind of very southern territorial issue on the Lumbee's behalf. We felt very strongly that the Klan was not going to invade our territory. And so we prevented them from holding this rally. So I tweeted this photograph of that night, and probably got more retweets than anything I've ever tweeted. But then the few days later, this protest eruption in Durham occurred when the statue was taken down, and of course folks say that the Klan was not actually marching, that it was a rumor, but the Klan was actually marching. They were coming to Durham, to downtown Durham. And I remember regretting that I had posted that tweet, and I sent this whole other series of tweets to try to provide context, which is very silly. on Twitter. But the reason I regretted it was because if you don't understand the context of that story with the Lumbees and the Klan, that's commemorating it amounts to an endorsement of violence in one way or another. When in fact, one of the reasons the Klan was so roundly defeated without anyone actually being killed is because the Robeson County Sheriff's Department refused to protect the Klan. They went to the Grand Dragon, Catfish Cole, and said, "We are not here to protect you. We are going to be here to protect the Lumbees who are going to be gathering to protest essentially against your presence." And so the police played an interesting role in that incident to actually prevent greater violence from happening. But by looking at that image or kind of seeing that a note about that event, you're not going to understand that context and the kind of, you know, the sort of dialogue that had to take place on multiple sides of the issue. And so I just, you know, offer that as that seems to be worth commemorating, right? But no, in fact, it's also more complicated. We've got to think about things, not do them lightly. So speaking of context, Sheffield was kind enough to share this set of images, which, speaking of what, you know, what Hitler statues do you see in Nazi, in Germany, or anywhere in that part of the world? Lithuania has gone through a process to remove its monuments to communist leaders and thinkers.
Yeah, my favorite one is actually one we had in, I saw in Ukraine, where they converted a statue of Lenin into Darth Vader. and it looks great, and I have a before and after of that, and turn it into a Wi-Fi hotspot too. So it's a creative use of a statue.
So,
yeah, but Stalin's world, we don't need that at the History Center.
You don't want these.
You had that few acres in Midtown you were talking
about.
Yeah, you
said you had 2 acres.
Yeah,
we've got 33 acres in Buckhead.
I think you're ready.
We don't. It's not big enough. For
it is. You don't need Lee's world?
No. We're good. We have Stone Mountain. You can drive out there and see all the Lee you want.
And see all the Lee in the world.
What struck me when I went to Germany were the nodes on the ground.
The stumbling stones.
Yeah. Those were, I didn't know what they were.
Tell us what they are.
They are places where Jews lived and were removed. You know, I think the first day I didn't know, and then I just sort of like almost stubbed my toe, and someone explained to me what they were, because they're very reticent. The Germans are reticent to discuss things as well. So as much as they've done the removal, they also remove so much that it's they can't talk about race. So I was with a group of black German graduate students, and they were talking about the discrimination they were facing from a mostly all-white professorate, and that they don't have the language by which to discuss what is wrong, because they can't even say, to say race is to sort of be Nazi-like. Mm-hmm. And so they've sort of removed it from their lexicon, and they, you know, the assumption is that we're all good, we're all done, everything's fine. But it silenced everyone from being able to talk about the fact that they want to maybe have a group of black German grad students who are in this organization. And, you know, they ask for some funding, and they're like, well, that's, you know. So the removal for them went almost multiple steps past useful.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of the silencing. Like, because as much as I want to, I wouldn't have a problem with, you know, a lot of this stuff coming down. I, you know, could put it somewhere. I do think the removal of our ability to have a conversation about our past is, or our present, being shaped by our past, is also problematic. So this whole colorblind language and lexicon that we use to talk about, like, I don't see race. Well, yeah, you do. You know, everyone sees that I'm black, and I'm really cool with it. Like, you know, I'm glad to be who I am.
Yeah.
I'm not ashamed or hurt by it. And so if you recognize my blackness, that's fine.
That's okay.
And so I don't want us to silence ourselves from from talking about hard history.
I'd just like to say one other thing about Germany that I found interesting, and that is that multiple times when I would go to universities and give talks, people would ask me, almost every single time I went anywhere new, people always ask me, grad students, professors, what is the process in the U.S.? Could you describe your process of coming to terms with your past, with slavery, with lynching, with Jim Crow, segregation? You know, what process, can you describe for us the process you've gone through to try to come to terms with that past? And I would, you know, the first time I was asked that, I was taken aback, and then I sort of thought, oh, okay, I understand what you're talking about. And I would say, we don't have a process. And then they would, invariably, they would look at me like I was an idiot. Like, how could you be a professor and not know what the process is? and I would just really try to assure them that, in fact, I might be an idiot, but in fact, there wasn't a process. And they were really shocked by that. And I don't say that to discount what Blair Kelly is saying about certain ideas about what can and can't be spoken. But they have made such a project across the nation of having public history sites, the stumbling stones, the public history monuments, memorials, museums, museums to terrorism and describing torture and describing, you know, the Holocaust and concentration camps preserved and discussions about this. You know, school children have to go to these sites. They have to have discussions about it. And they really couldn't comprehend that we had no sort of official process of talking about these kinds of issues. So I just offer that as an example of how other parts of the world are thinking about the past.
They're much more compliant than we are.
Is it the rugged individualism or something that prevents it?
I mean, the interesting thing, the contrast of Stalin's world is what the Soviet Union, when they de-Stalinized and took down all the statues of Stalin throughout the whole country, that was, interestingly, to support the communist regime, right? Because Stalin had been discredited, and so they wanted to get rid of all those Stalin statues. Until the last one that was standing is one that I went to see in 1985 in Gori, because it was the last statue of Stalin left. They were all gone. Guess what they're doing now? And that one eventually disappeared after Georgia became a separate republic. Mm-hmm. They're putting up new statues of Stalin. Because he's a strong man, reminds them of Vladimir. It's just interesting that was a whitewashing of their past to support the current regime, mm-hmm. Which is really the opposite of anyway, it's just interesting to what we have.
Yeah. Useful to think about how it unfolds in other places. These are two photographs taken by Grace in the aftermath of the violence in Charlottesville, and I think they're striking for a number of reasons. You want to comment, Grace, on?
Well, I mean, I think this image was actually taken the day after the August invasion, and I just thought it was really touching that somebody had put that sign there, especially since we'd recently renamed the park Emancipation Park. Some citizen had decided to rename it again after Heather Heyer, who was, you know, the woman who was killed right in the downtown area by the car. So I think that pretty much speaks for itself. But the tarp over Lee, and Jackson is also tarped, although our anonymous Confederate soldier isn't tarped. I like to think of this as the Christos come to Charlottesville. And this is our city council's answer to the fact that there's a lawsuit preventing the monuments from being removed. And then there's also, you know, argument about interpreting, and that is in part argument over interpreting state laws about whether it can be removed or not, which hinges on the fact of whether it's a war memorial or a piece of art. So they're debating that because what they decide to call it then has something that, you know, is they can remove it or not remove it. So there's a lawsuit now, and the city can't take them down at this moment. And so this is the recontextualization that we have in Charlottesville now, are these tarps. They've been cut off at least 5 times already. I'm not sure how long we as taxpayers are going to be able to keep this up, but so far we're persevering. And they've now wrapped them much more securely, and you couldn't cut them off easily now, so they may stay up there now. But this is the recontextualization that we can actually do at this moment, and I personally like it, and I think it's got something to say. But I'd be interested to hear what people in the audience might have to say about it, or panelists might comment on this.
Charlottesville was really painful for me, because I mean, as much as Charlottesville is not a neutral location for me at all. I think, you know, of the student, Martise Johnson, who was beaten on the corner by the ABC cops. We were, in my year, pepper sprayed at a bowling, inside of a bowling alley by ABC cops. So it certainly was a site of violence before this. It has a long history of violence against black bodies. But it was particularly difficult to see in the now, when I've been grappling with Charlottesville pretty well, in my own experience, to see, you know, in the parking deck, I can recognize where someone's beaten nearly to death with the sticks and bats. And, you know, there's very little recognition of how that must feel to be a black Charlottesvillian in our national discourse. So as much as this is like a, you know, a funny back and forth with folks who are trying to decide of how to manage the symbol, the reminder of the kind of extreme violence can be invoked against people's bodies in places that, you know, some folks call home. I have students who live, you know, three blocks from here who are afraid to live in Charlottesville now. Mm-hmm. I have, you know, folks on campus who, you know, had to send their kids to a place where Nazis marched across campus, talking about blood and soil. And, you know, whose blood, whose soil? It's a really interesting thing. Because, you know, in being at UVA, I always felt like I had a place because of the people who built the place.
Right.
And so that their contest is really something.
Yeah, I don't know that everybody actually knows this, but the Friday night march through the university with tiki torches, the students had moved into the rooms on the lawn. So the students were moved into those rooms that day. They moved in that morning. Not everyone moved in, but it was possible to move in, and a lot of people did. And there were students of color, Jewish students, you know, moving into those rooms hours before that march.
It seems that in a way, covering up Lee also allows for the people to not recognize what's happening to African Americans. The conversation remains focused on the statue when you cover it up in this fashion, similar to how in Chapel Hill we had police and riot gear surrounding Silent Sam, protecting the statue, not really dealing with the underlying issues that the statue represents. We have this charming boy, Robert E. Lee IV, his great-grandson, great-great-grandson?
Great-grandson.
Great-grandson.
Stone Mountain dedication in 1928. And to me, I mean, it's the two flags, right? It's about the reunification and that's, you know, what they were trying to do with all of this. And the whole Stone Mountain, which Grace has written this incredible article years ago on Stone Mountain, which is still the best.
Thank you.
We plagiarize it all the time. and use it to try to persuade our governor and others to focus on the issue, is it's about that reunification issue, and guess who's left out? And that's the real issue about that. Anyway, I just think that's a great encapsulation of that.
You could see children that same age at Lynchings, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We had three of those in Charlottesville too, speaking of. Not recently.
Yeah.
One source I think that can be a great source for combating the rhetoric of the lost cause in these kinds of moments are the voices of Union veterans. And I think there's been really interesting scholarship, and that should be circulated more publicly. In part, the timing of some of this kind of memorialization of the Confederacy has to do with the fact that Union veterans are aging and dying off, because a lot of Union veterans never get happy about this idea of reunification with the South, or you know, having sort of joint parades of veterans, or shaking hands and or celebrating a kind of martial valor, you know, on the battlefield that both the Confederacy and the Union shared. Some of the most you know, dedicated, very vocal critics of the kind of sweeping away of Reconstruction and turning sort of, you know, the white North and white South sort of coming back together, especially by this 1920s moment, or those Union veterans. And so I think it is important to note that some of the timing of this happening has to do with they're dying off, and they're not as strong of a voice out there, a group of very activist, politicized voters who are losing, you know, losing membership, so
and
to speak.
As a great historian I read said, the New South is a response to the New Negro, so that in part African-American resistance against all of this is the response. This is the erasure, to harken back both to the faithful slave and the Mammy Memorial efforts. You know, imagine if that had succeeded.
Yeah.
In addition to this,
if we had lots of mammies all over the South.
Yes, we would have just tons of mammy statues and sort of the faithful slave dedications in newspapers and at funerals. And so, you know, the death of that generation and the presence of resistance is, I think.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
She's the historian who said it.
Oh, thank you. I don't know how many people know that. I think you're in part, there were attempts to build mammy memorials everywhere, but they got pretty far with an attempt to build one in Washington, D.C., a mammy memorial in the 1920s. It came close to getting built, and it's very much a part of the same impulse to put up Robert E. Lee statues in that period.
Who were the loyal? Who were the faithful?
Yeah. Who were the good?
The good ones.
People.
Yeah. You problematic new Negroes are.
Yeah.
Not the right ones.
Not the right ones. Thank you again, Sheffield.
Well, you know, of course, I love this because you know it's Stone Mountain, it's Atlanta, Outkast is Atlanta, and it's humor. And one of the things that I think that we need to use more is humor, put a little humility in there too, to deal with some of these issues. And I just think that's great. And this one really trended really nicely for a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it lines up nicely, you know?
The Cadillac and the horses.
Yeah, yeah.
Modes of transport.
Yeah.
Critical.
Yeah.
For those of you that maybe have not seen Stone Mountain's memorial in person, that's obviously what the figures on the left depict, and then this is in a reimagination of the monument by an artist named Mac Williams. The CNN article cited here describes Mr. Williams saying, "Outcast unites Atlanta," the same way that Stone Mountain's monument, well, anyway, once united Atlanta. Outcast now unites Atlanta. And so anyway, thoughts on this juxtaposition? Blair, I know you have thoughts.
Maybe they play a concert.
She'll tweet about
too,
it later.
If you could scrape the front part of it off, that'd be awesome.
Well, that's been done before. You know, they put up various versions and blasted them off the mountain. So it can be done.
Mm-hmm. Pretty cool. I remember my mother talking about Stone Mountain, and you know, because I interviewed for jobs in the Atlanta area. She's like, "Well, you know, you don't need to live anywhere near that." You know, she was just trying to make sure that I understood where I would be welcome. But that, I mean, that's a realistic thing. There are places in the Triangle where I probably shouldn't really buy a house, and there are places where I could, and be welcome.
The irony today is about 60% of the people who use that park are people of color.
Yes.
And they go by that every day.
Mm-hmm.
And who live in that area. I mean, just the irony is just.
Well, because Atlanta has become
changed,
the black mecca.
Right.
Of that part of the South. So, yes.
So it's.
And yet there are still places where you shouldn't go if you left that mecca and plunk down and try to eat lunch necessarily.
Are they still doing the laser show?
Oh yeah, oh yeah. I've now been gone 57 years without making it, so I can't tell you about it. But yeah, they're still doing the laser show.
Well, I had to go for research. So, but what they used to do in the 90s, the answer to what do we do with this giant Confederate, literally a mountain here in the midst of the city, when people have different ideas about it, and we want to attract a diverse paying audience to come to our park, was they created a laser show, and they would draw Martin Luther King's face over the the triptych up here, and have his have a dream speech playing. Now they'd follow that with like Ugga the Georgia Bulldog, and then the Ramblin' Rack from Georgia Tech, and you know, it was kind of a let's throw everything in the mix and you'll like something if you're here watching. But I always loved the Martin Luther King, you know, laser over the over the Confederates.
It's earnest.
I don't know that it accomplished exactly what they hoped, but you know, they were giving it a shot.
Yeah. And it's the 90s.
Yeah.
Affirmative action was the big issue. Remember that? We would love to hear y'all's questions and comments. There's a micro, if you feel free to speak up, and then there's microphones, one right there and one right there. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, yes, thank you for this opportunity. I'm wondering, since the a strategic thing that needs to happen are the conversations in the legislature, and I guess I'm wondering if there's a coordinated strategy or how you think the conversations in the legislature to reverse the laws, what you think is the potential or hope for that, and how, you know, whether you think referendum, you know, any thoughts about how that's going to happen, and if there's a coordinated effort by anyone to driving that strategic conversations and reversing the legislation.
Does anybody want to speak to North Carolina?
Yeah, I'll leave it to the North Carolina resident.
Oh, that's great. You leave it to the employee of the state of North
Carolina. Right, the state employee.
I think
dial up your legislator right now. Yeah,
I think the gerrymandering of districts in 2010 is at the root of a stalemate in the state of North Carolina around a lot of these issues. And so I think until those maps are redrawn in ways that substantively better represent natural looking districts in the state of North Carolina, I think you'll get the same kinds of results over and over and over again. And so it's a tough thing. I guess we were having elections today. I hope people voted. I do think it's important for people not just to focus on our big sort of watershed elections, but those smaller elections where a lot of decision making on local levels and in the legislature happen. And so I think we took had a tremendous turnout in 2008 and a pretty regular turnout in 2010 that has had larger consequences for the state of North Carolina than 2008 did.
I don't know if others in the audience maybe have up-to-date information about such a thing. It strikes me that there is a coordinated effort to redraw districts, perhaps not to reflect natural communities, but also to reflect democratic interests. But that's probably the root cause, certainly, of these number of deadlocked issues that we have.
And there's also the rethinking of the judicial districts,
yes.
Yeah.
Which doesn't move us forward in terms of representation and equal representation for population.
I mean, I think in Virginia the law will be changed But I think in the short run, even before that happens, they'll be able to, I mean, if they declare the monuments works of art, they can be moved. So I think it's going to happen, and perhaps, I mean, this is a sad tragedy because of the violence and because of the trauma of the events in August, and frankly, the expense. I mean, the state has had to spend a tremendous amount of money in response to that during the events and afterwards. So I think that they will be removed. It's just a question of, you know, how drawn out is it going to be?
Let's go in the back. Just a little bit. Yeah, well, I think myself and the staff at the center, we're thinking broadly about building on conversations that have already happened in Chapel Hill about our local controversies. And so that was sort of criteria number one, is bringing folks together that could speak to some of what was going on here locally, but also region-wide, because these are things that have unfolded, of course, across the region. That was sort of the first consideration. The second consideration was that, yes, the diversity of points of view that we could acquire and represent. I think there's some reluctance, as I did a lot of research looking for appropriate panelists, there's some reluctance on the part of people who feel strongly that the monuments should stay, to come speak in a forum like the one CSAS can offer, if that makes sense. One of the things that we do, and on August 14th, we sort of made a decision to do what we do, which is to host critical conversations about important topics. One of the things that we do is that we bring together folks who whose knowledge is strongly grounded in research and scholarship. And a number of the people that we looked into or that I reached out to who might be able to speak to that specific perspective were not willing to come. And I don't know if that was because they felt that their work was not, would not be, that their point of view would not be well received. I didn't get that level of feedback from folks. But I did, I do have a sense that there's, the echo chamber that you identified is significant and a problem. One of the things I learned tonight was the variety of perspectives on the consequences for what happens when you do remove or relocate monuments, things that I had never really considered, such as how in Germany, for example, we can't talk about race because the commemoration of the Nazi era has been so thoroughly cleansed or removed. Unfortunately, I can't answer that necessarily why those folks turned us down.
Well, as a lawyer, I could argue the other side.
That you can argue the other side.
If you want me to do that,
You know. And there was also, there was a thought in inviting, especially these three individuals, that because they speak in various public ways to public audiences, that they're constantly listening to people who disagree with that core value. And I could, as I sort of indicated, I can speak to the other side as well. I mean, you know, I was taught, for example, as a Lumbee, to sort of ignore these places, you know, that they weren't me, that this is not us idea, was that these monuments didn't represent me, and so I could just act like they didn't exist, right? And therefore, oh, maybe it's not such a problem that they're there. I mean, who is that really a problem for? Well, of course, it's a problem for my neighbors, family and friends who feel that these symbols do not represent them and that they can't access the public squares in which these symbols exist. So especially after Charlottesville, I began to change my own sort of perspective on what needed to happen here. But, you know, I know it's not a very satisfactory answer, but I think the conversation does continue. And part of our purpose at CSAS is to provide the information that's research-based from folks that have really looked deeply at the issue.
You know, I was just invited and obviously didn't help put the panel together, but I would say that in the academy, the people that used to be, that at least that I know, that are specialists in Southern history, that used to argue for a recontextualization, strongly argue for, you know, recontextualize these statues, but don't remove them. We can't, as historians, advocate for erasing history. That wasn't my position, but that was a strong position amongst my colleagues in the history department. And all of those colleagues have now changed their minds. So I don't know if that, you know, has some effect too on attempts to get panelists, but this is a issue that is so much at play that a lot of people are re-examining, you know, what they used to think about it and are not necessarily in the same place that they might have been even a few months ago.
Yeah, I mean,
some scholars. So that's a problem.
Yeah, and so I'll say that I've moved on the issue in the 2 years since Charleston, and that I've had a higher degree of that, you know, confidence that we could contextualize most of them than I do after Charlottesville.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, that's what segregation was a creation of an everyday etiquette that allowed people to be in their places and to mask the violence at the heart of what it took to enforce it. And so only when we pierce the surface do we see the violence that undergirds these monuments and these spaces, right? It isn't kind of neutral park, you know, green trees
and that's what
pieces.
I learned from Charlottesville, starting to think about it when the Charleston massacre happened, and then really coming to a conclusion.
But that violence is always embedded.
It's
right?
always there,
right.
I was blind to it.
So when Carr talked, in the dedication of Silent Sam about beating a woman on the street, for him to bring both into the same conversation was the one, right? So that Black people should know where they should be on the street, and they should know that this is not their space. And I don't have to say it, I don't have to beat you every day, but this is here to remind you of where your place is. And so, you know, that masking is a powerful thing. And so you have people who grew up in segregated South who can say to you, oh, it wasn't violent. Mm-hmm. You know, I never saw, you know, people, we got along. But if anyone dared to pierce it, then you suddenly saw what was the violence erupted.
And that's what the civil rights activists so brilliantly put out on public display through the new mediums that were available in the 1960s, right? So they pierced the system, and then that violence was on display to put in the newspaper and on television, and mm-hmm. and that's exactly how they were effective.
Mm-hmm. And helped persuade a lot of Americans that things needed to change.
Yeah.
Thank you for asking that question, because it's certainly been something that's on my mind. Yes.
I have been asked this question many times, so I'll give it a go and then turn it over to these folks. I don't think there can be a universal principle, where do we stop? I think that the people that ask that question, we can't do this because where will it end? They're asking that question so as not to do anything. That is their response to this. We can't do anything, and we have to have a reason for that. So here's a reason, we don't want to get rid of George Washington. I think that is a completely disingenuous, I mean, not your question, but that response is a way to not face the issue and not deal with the fact that Confederate memorials are profoundly different than other kinds of monuments, which we might also decide to take down as a society. It's not for me personally to decide. But it is a different thing to have a monument up to a figure like Jefferson, I mean, all over the landscape that I live in, who is a founder of the nation, wrote the Declaration of Independence, is a slaveholder. I mean, you can talk, about all of the complexities, the relationship with Sally Hemings,
Merciless Indian savages. Right,
exactly.
There, in the Declaration.
There is no more racist document than Notes on the State of Virginia. I mean, the man is a pioneer of radical racism and also writes the Declaration of Independence. So there you have it all in one package, right? But that is, you know, that he is being commemorated for his role in founding the nation. We might decide we want to take down those statues. As I said, it's not for me to say. But that's not the same thing as taking down a statue of Robert E. Lee, who led an army in rebellion against the government, the legitimate government of our country, or a statue to somebody like Jefferson Davis or other Confederate generals. I mean, the president of the Confederacy. That's a completely different kind of category. So one, I'd welcome discussions about all of these historic figures, but I find the question itself, and especially the way that Trump put it and others have put it in the public sphere it's a reason not to do anything, not to have any conversation, not to look at the ways that historical figures are different from each other, and also the ways in which these historical figures are complicated, and we need to think very hard about why we're commemorating them, and all of their sort of flaws as well as strengths.
And I think that masks the fact that, you know, my family reunion went to, it's not masking that, my family reunion went to Mount Vernon, which was pretty funny. And I was like, oh no, guide, I'm so sorry, guide. Because my family was just like, well, what about? And so they were very.
Someplace centrally located.
Yeah, they were
everybody
like,
can get to.
It's like going with grad students on a tour.
No, it was worse. Yeah. all my aunts and my cousins, it was worse. But I was pleasantly surprised. I was trying to be neutral. I was trying to be a public historian and just sort of take in the tour. I've been to Monticello many times. I have a student that works at Montpelier. So I know about the work that's going on there. So I really wanted to see what was happening at Mount Vernon. They're doing the work. That interpreter was completely ready for my little feisty family. She talked very well and in multiple places in the house, outside the house, on the grounds about enslavement and the history of enslavement. She had detailed stories about the enslaved by name. It's much better than Monticello, where they're like Sally Hemings in one room and then you never hear her name again. And so it's important to know that there is work being done, and we are changing the way that we interpret our founding fathers. And so I think that's great. I think that's, you know, to reclaim those spaces so that the Native people who were displaced to make the home of our first president and the enslaved people who worked on that land and were dislocated from their families in different kinds of ways and dislocated from the ownership of their labor. Mm-hmm. I think that's a conversation we have to have. And so I love that. I mean, we are all complex and messy people. None of us are completely coherent at any good time, and all of us are capable of doing things or accepting things that are wrong. And so if we don't know that about the people of the past, then we'll never know it about ourselves, and we can't do good work about ourselves. So, let's do that work. Yeah. I'm excited.
Well, I got a call from an official in Chicago, and about, he said, I want to talk to you about how you deal with monuments. I'm like, what's your problem? and he goes, well, the mayor's called, and
Bulls, Michael Jordan.
we have this this General Sheridan statue. Oh, I said, you mean that guy that went and destroyed the Shenandoah Valley and said that, you know, if you're a crow, you'd have to pack your lunch to fly over it after I got through with it? That guy? And they said, yeah, that guy. I said, what's his problem in Chicago? And he goes, well, apparently, which he probably didn't say, but he's credited with saying only good Indians are dead Indians.
No, yeah.
And he did kill a lot of buffalo, and he did a lot of bad things in the Indian Wars. I'm like, you know, this is probably not a place to stop. You have at that guy. That's fine with me. But I think the answer is somewhere. You got to stop somewhere, but you got to start somewhere. And I think that's right. If you just shuts down But it also, we need to get into the fact that people are complicated and admit that.
You're just starting somewhere.
I would just like to offer a quote from Bryan Stevenson, made in a completely different context, but I think it really applies across the board. And
the author
of course,
Just Mercy.
Yeah, the leader of the Equal Justice Initiative, a personal hero of mine, and a friend. And he says of people who were incarcerated on death row, you know, no one should be reduced to the worst thing that they've ever done. No one should be. And I think it, strange as it sounds to take that more broadly, but I think everybody has done bad and good things. And I think that we have to acknowledge that in the public sphere, and we have to think about the complicated, as you said, messiness of history and how most people have done bad and good things. And so I think we need to start somewhere, not immediately talk about where we're going to stop.
Yes, ma'am. I mean, I would love to put a war bonnet on Silent Sam and dress his rifle as a war club. I think we could probably take turns every week doing something with that monument that would allow people to see it in a different light. You know, that it's in one way it's ordinary. It's not necessarily kind of worth all of the political energy that's being put into protecting it. But you know, I think the juxtaposition of the speaker ban plaque, if y'all are not aware of where it is, it's literally in front of Silent Sam at the wall that separates Franklin Street from the campus. And so when you're standing at the speaker ban plaque, you can see it and Silent Sam in the same frame, and it's just the most interesting of juxtapositions of UNC Chapel Hill's history as a place of free speech and freedom of thought that is protected consistently by students who are truly the front lines of who's going to protect free speech at UNC. It's going to be students. What's happened recently around Silent Sam, I think, is a related phenomenon. But when you look at the two monuments together, you see Silent Sam representing a version of Chapel Hill's history that venerates it as a white space, as a space only for, exclusively for, well, white men at that time. And the fact that we don't agree with that now is really obvious in the fact that with the speaker ban plaque being right there. But I'm also curious about who else has figured that out, so thank you. I'm glad that that is present. Yes, sir.
I'm involved in Orange County and Hillsborough's history in particular and preservation. And so this is a really interesting and vital conversation. One funny aside I'll tell you right away about Orange County, Hillsborough is the county seat. And the only reason we don't have a statue monument issue is the UDC, which is headed by a very powerful member of the UDC in Hillsborough. Instead of building a monument at the courthouse, decided to build the only one that we've ever heard of, was the Confederate Memorial Library.
And there's a whole
so
library.
This was built for the WPA project, completely funded by them, and had a big, you know, Confederate Memorial Library sign over it. It evolved took the letters off the front of it. This was kind of early on in the whole removing of letters. So all of us in Hillsborough who deal with Hillsborough history have a big sigh of relief. We don't have a statue to get to fight over. I was a conceptualist who believed that everything should be conceptualized. I think we've moved beyond that for most statues. I would say this, though, about Silent Sam. I do think that both the ladies who women who were on the panel pointed a good reason why you might consider that a statue you keep and you put in do conceptualize. In that, I don't think that we progressives or those who look at white supremacy and see history as for what it is can feel too good if all these things come down, because you want places that you walk by and you say that is a symbol of a past that we've moved beyond, and you need to use those teaching moments for that. Whether you're taking people on tours to show them in downtown Charlottesville, or you're walking by Silent Sam, it's got a plaque up there that says what Julius Shakespeare Carr said about when he dedicated that in 1913. So I really do believe some statues maybe have a value that should remain, as bad as it may seem to us today, that a generation, my grandchildren or others, may see and have to remember what we did in the white supremacy movement. And that was such a comprehensive movement. The historians, you talked about historians, you know, history's been taught for 20 or 30 years, but God, when I came to UNC long ago, we were just moving out of the Phillips Dunning School of History, which basically said Reconstruction was a horrible thing. Travesty on the South. The academics, the university was absolutely guilty of reinforcing all, well into the 1960s. I mean, that wasn't a long time ago. So I only would just ask, what was the tipping point, I guess, to get my question, what is the tipping point, do you think, when progressives begin to see the monument issue as a place to start the dialogue or eradicate versus we need a broader discussion maybe of reparations or exactly what we can do to address what white supremacy has done to us as a country? It's not kind of our history. Kind of long rambling, but...
I wonder, when we say we need people to walk by it to remember it, some people don't need to walk by it to remember it. And that their lived experience, so the lived experience of my children, they won't need to walk by Silent Sam to remember this history. They're living this history. They're living in the residue of it by living in the American South and by living in this country, by living in a country where it's sort of up for debate whether or not some of the citizens should be randomly killed by police, and that should be something that we just tolerate as a consequence of what we look like or our past. And so I have to educate my children in a completely different way than other people have to educate their children. And so they'll already know. If they go to UNC Chapel Hill, they'll already know just fine this history. So it's for me, it is the question of what are we teaching the rest of the children about all the histories, about the histories that segregate our schools at higher rates than they have been in decades, about histories that disempower whole communities to think about the processes around them, that are gentrifying Durham, North Carolina at a rapid pace. How do we talk about all those things to a community that doesn't have to care and doesn't have to think about it? And so I don't know that I want my kids to be punished by it. Like, I pay to go here, I pay taxes to live here, and I also got to see this stuff that, you know, I have to grapple with and no one else is dealing with. That everyone else has the privilege of just walking by. And so that's what I want to say. I want to protect our children better from the everyday violence of segregation.
And I think if we want to actually talk about the history of white supremacy and segregation, you know, from the late 19th century forward, we could build different kinds of monuments. And, you know, again, Equal Justice Initiative and Bryan Stevenson are building this lynching monument. that has components where it's sort of modeled on the stumbling stones, where a piece of the monument will go and be present in the space where the person was actually killed, and then there's the central monument. And so there's other ways to imagine putting that history into the public sphere that is not, that does not involve continuing to maintain and support and centralize the monuments put up by the people who are creating that system of segregation.
Excuse me. Is this on? Can people hear me? I have a relative large. So I have a,
ooh, there he is.
Okay, I have a comment. So I'm just to be clear, I have a comment. But then I have a question. Okay, so my comment is, as an outsider who's not from North Carolina, when I saw Silent Sam, I did a double take and I instantly felt uncomfortable as a woman of color, right? So I just wanted to kind of, you know, return back to Melinda's point about how this is my adopted home, right? And I identify as neither black nor white, but I definitely feel a sense of alienation when I see symbols of the Confederacy. And so I also think that while we are talking about this in a local context, because we are in the US South, there are people from outside who come here. And I was on campus when we had the pro-Confederate protest, and I talked to a couple, a mixed race couple from New Jersey, who were completely freaked out by seeing big pickup trucks with the Confederate symbol and like Dixie playing, right? Like they had no idea what was going on. They had dropped their college age student off and they were, you know, they couldn't believe that this is, you know, what they were entering into, right? And so I spent an hour kind of reassuring them that actually UNC is not this totally weird racist place where we're constantly having these things happen every week, but then at the same time saying like, but yes, you know, there is racism and white supremacy that happens and on and on. So my question that is more pertinent to this panel is, you know, James Meeser, who our former chancellor, had at one time argued for contextualizing Silent Sam, right? Putting up plaques and really kind of contextualizing the way that the statue had been erected during an era of particular white supremacy, right, relative to the post, you know, Reconstruction era. He has since publicly come out and said that he doesn't believe that we can do that anymore. That once you have people coming in and using the symbols of the Confederacy for white nationalism and white supremacy and Nazism, the time for contextualization is over. And so that's, so my question is, can we, after Charlottesville, can we really expect to rehabilitate the symbols of the Confederacy?
No.
Well, I don't think anybody, I don't think anybody who is talking about contextualizing is saying rehabilitate them, right? That's not the point. The point is to call them out. And the question is, can you do that and keep them in the public sphere? And that's an open question that communities have to wrestle with. And obviously there's maybe an answer for Charlotte's, for Chapel Hill that's different from other places. And you have to see. And it just depends. But after Charlottesville, like I said, it is much more difficult. And once these white supremacists have locked onto it, you know, they're now controlling the field.
The rhetoric and the dialogue.
I think the easiest answer to that is the polarization of the nation and the fact that people are being pushed to take a side. And even as we have been talking about, and I've been saying that neo-Confederates and other kinds of white supremacists have developed more sophisticated ways of using these symbols, it seems, at least I would argue as a scholar who has studied the 20th century history of this use that they've always been white supremacist symbols. So it's not that they're newly white supremacist symbols. I didn't mean to suggest that. I meant to suggest that people have figured out new ways to deploy them, but that they've always been white supremacist symbols. But I think the main reason why there's such a sort of movement towards removing them now, frankly, is that a lot of white liberals have been sort of forced to take a side in ways that they weren't necessarily forced to before, because you won't find a whole lot of communities of color that wanted those kinds of symbols to remain. And there have always been white allies to those communities. So I think it's more what I like to think of as, or not like to, but what I think of as the muddled middle that's feeling pushed one way or the other. But I mean, that, you know, I'm a historian and I look at the past, and so you're asking me for an observation about the present. And so I will say that that's my best sense, but, you know.
And I mean, you know, if you look at the data that we do have, the polls aren't with removal, right? They aren't with removal right now.
Mm-hmm.
So as much as there's a conversation about it, the majority of Americans don't favor it.
Let's do one more question.
As Tim Tyson always talks about sort of mythology, you know, he grew up learning about how the slaves helped bury the silver in the yard, and then when he started doing research, he discovered that there were no slaves, there was no silver, and there was no yard. So it's masking a lot of people who were disempowered by a few very wealthy people who owned vast numbers of other humans.
I want to thank you all for coming. Thank you guys for being here.